Free speech, the right to express opinion without censorship or restraint. Should that apply to us all the time? Or should those with views we don't agree with be silenced? This is Roundtable with me, Matthew Moore. Now, many of the world's greatest minds have been forged in British universities. For centuries, they have been bastions of free speech. In the 1970s, no platforming was adopted to keep extreme views off campus. Now, some are questioning whether it's gone too far, excluding the voices of people with different, but not necessarily dangerous, opinions. And who should decide what can or can't be said in a public place anyway? At what point should free speech give way to censorship, if at all?
There's a debate going on that's testing the limits of free speech.
We take back what they
say! British universities have worked hard over the years to ban fascist views from campuses. But is so-called no platforming also stopping other voices from joining student debate? And is there something more at stake? Is shutting down free and open discussion calling into question what it means to live in a liberal democracy? No platforming in universities started in the 1970s when neo-Nazi parties were on the rise. Fearing the movement would infiltrate student life, the National Union of Students banned them from speaking at university events. 30 years on, and the list has expanded to include a number of groups, some of which have been banned by the government. Universities are also free to decide who they want to welcome onto their campuses. And it seems students think it's a good idea. In a recent survey, 63% said they supported the policy.
When someone has a view that you're less of a human because of the color of your skin or because of your religion, you don't deserve to live in this country or even be alive for that matter. By sitting around the same table and having a conversation, you're signaling that what they're saying has some sort of merit and it requires some sort of response.
But the policy has sparked controversy, with campaigners branding it an assault on free speech. More and more people with diverse political views are being pressured not to speak at universities. Here's Nobel Peace Laureate Mohamed El Baradei being heckled during a university talk. And the list of speakers who have faced calls to be no platformed in recent years has some well-known faces on it. They include British Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson, writer Germaine Greer, WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange, and even Peter Tatchell, who's been a human rights campaigner for the past 50 years. Some said they were targeted by fringe elements who simply disagreed with their point of view. Has no platforming been hijacked? And is it making our universities a less tolerant place?
If someone's really right-wing or really left-wing, and we think their ideas might be dangerous, in a sense that there are very, very far from what we believe, I don't think we should ban them. I think we should engage with them, we should have a conversation. Maybe we learn from them, maybe we can change their mind.
Student unions say it's up to them to decide who they can invite and who to exclude. And the debate on no platforming shows that they remain as politically active as ever. But the danger is whether it becomes a substitute for challenging people and ideas. And whether free speech, so fiercely protected in this country, will suffer as a result.
So are we witnessing an attack on free speech? At today's roundtable is the former General Secretary of Manchester University's Student Union, Na Akwa. She backs her university's decision to no platform some individuals. Wayman Bennett is the Joint Secretary for the campaign group Unite Against Fascism and an advocate for no platforming. To my left is the human rights activist Peter Tatchell. He believes no platforming controversial speakers means we do fail to expose and counter their ideas. Also at the table is Professor Eric Hines from Queen Mary University. He's the author of hate speech and democratic censorship. Peter Tatchell, if I may start with you, as the only person mentioned in that report, let's talk about your case. You had, well, let's say for our international viewers who aren't aware of your work, for nearly half a century, you've been campaigning for gay rights and the rights of others, and now you found yourself being accused of intolerant views and being someone trying to exclude you from a debate. Can you just tell us what happened?
Well, strictly speaking, I wasn't platformed. What happened was a National Union of Students officer said that she was not prepared to appear on a panel if I was part of it. So she was subtly pressuring the authorities to drop me as a condition for having her on the platform. She made allegations that I was transphobic and racist, but when asked to provide the evidence, she couldn't. So in the end, I went ahead and spoke, but she declined to appear.
Let's go to Na Akwa now. You were the former General Secretary of Manchester Students' Union, and you know the National Union students very, very well.
Yeah, very well.
What do you make of the LGBT officer's stance against Peter Tatchell, who everyone in this country knows for many, many decades has stuck up for people's rights?
Well, I think it's an interesting thing because obviously that sort of situation is, as you've rightly said, you were not platformed because you were the one ultimately on the platform and she chose not to be on it. I think it'd be really interesting discussion if she just said, oh, I don't want to go, I'm a bit ill. That's your personal choice. As a person, you can choose who you want to be on a platform with as your right.
We're talking about a gay activist's advocacy, which came up against potentially the charge of being making racist remarks. Yeah. When you have two minorities claiming precedence, isn't that a very difficult issue to decide?
I think that's a shame, actually. I really hate situations where two minority groups are going against each other. But I think when you're going to say something and you put yourself out there, you have to take criticism as well, and some people are not going to like what you've said, and so they also then have the right to not want to engage with you. It's their sort of ability to do so. That actually is the freedoms that we're all sitting here talking about. So to feel that then you then have the right to say, well, no, you should have sat on a platform with me for free speech doesn't really make sense.
Can I just say that I did defend the right of the NUS officer to not appear on the platform with me. I said that was her right. I respected that view.
But you've also made a really big deal of it and sort of travelled around.
Just broaden it out a little bit. Wayman Bennett, back in the 80s, you were a big proponent of no platforming in specific cases.
Yeah.
Just tell us why you were so passionate about that issue.
Because in Hatfield Polytechnic, at an anti-racist event, one of the people performing there was an anti-racist event. A group of racists organised by the National Front, the forerunners of the BNP, came in and stabbed a student who unfortunately died. So the question for no platform isn't the question of, it's the right. The right to life, I think, comes above the right to freedom of speech. And it wasn't possible for black, LGBT or other people who they disagreed with, who they thought were subhuman, to operate on this day. In the day, they'd use the platform, and at night, they would attack people or take lists with people. So it was about preserving the right to an education free from attack and free from those positions. Any other position is abstract, really, if you can't walk around the campus without being attacked by people.
Let me bring in Professor Eric Hines. When you look at the policy of no platforming, do you see its value, or do you think that free speech is being curtailed?
It's very detrimental to any university. The people you disagree with, the people you hate and despise, those are the ones you should be inviting first. And they shouldn't be there as gurus for students to sit there passively like sponges, simply to be dictated to. They should be there the way you do anything else in a university, the way you read Aristotle or Karl Marx. They should be there for scrutiny, for questioning. It shouldn't be comfortable for them. It should be hard for them. So if you don't like them, if you think they're dangerous, they're the ones to invite.
No?
That's what a university is for.
And definitely, and that happens. We do have, I think there's a sort of weird sort of system where everyone thinks that this happens every day. We're talking about incidents of one in years in many places. In Manchester, I think one. And actually, we have those challenges. Those people are coming onto campus, but also we're having those discussions within students. Students have a whole range of opinions, and of course they do. They reflect society. And so we have them within ourselves. Different societies operate, different groups operate. And so actually, we're having them. I don't think that to be challenged necessarily means you need to have a certain speaker, a certain opinion to necessarily have that challenge. We're still having it, and I think the issue is people not thinking that we are.
Let's be clear. Marine Le Pen and Le Pen's were allowed to go to French universities. They've now built an organisation of 50,000 on the campuses. That's a literal danger to those people. In Britain, the BNP, the National Front, were prevented.
Just going back to Marine Le Pen, you're saying that a woman like her should not be debated with publicly?
I think people are trying to build fascist organisations. People that are racist, Islamophobes, or do you mean? And
but in the end, she actually had to debate with Macron, and she lost. But she also garnered 11 million views. Doesn't that suggest that she has a right to argue her case and be defeated?
I wouldn't invite Hitler onto my campus. Not because I don't believe that 6 million Jews did not die because they couldn't articulate an argument about what's wrong with them. The problem is if you allow these people to build an organisation, they then use that organisation to disrupt all democratic principles on campus. And so esoterically, of course, one idea is the same as another idea, but when it's backed up by boots and knives, it becomes completely different as an experience.
Professor Hines, I mean, it almost feels defeatist to say that you cannot invite people on with extreme views because you're not sure of your own argument.
Actually, what's interesting, the linking of dangerous views with boots and knives, if you look at the G20 meeting in Hamburg, for the first time, the German press now has massively been speaking about left-wing hate speech. And in fact, there was a lot of violence there. So we banned Marxist ideas too, revolutionary Marxism, Leninism. Marine Le Pen, I'm certainly no fan of her, and I was delighted to see the way Macron really, using speech, was able to refute pretty much point for point everything she spoke for. But the fact is there are plenty of her adherents at universities. There's no greater incidence of knife crimes there, right? Knife crimes, that's part of the criminal law, and it doesn't matter what your motive is, right? The criminal law deals with that. There's no question about that.
Yeah, I think we need to recognize that if you simply ban someone, the ideas they represent and the ideas their followers represent don't go away. In fact, they fester and remain. But if you can, if you like, give them a platform, but then challenge and debunk their ideas, often they will emerge discredited. And this is exactly what happened to the leader of the far-right British National Party, Nick Griffin, when he appeared on BBC's Question Time panel. Actually, I didn't want him to appear. But in hindsight, after he did appear, I thought it was marvellous because he was debunked and flawed by the other panellists who exposed his far-right views, and he emerged from that programme damaged politically and morally.
I think Peter's saying is that if you have somebody who holds extreme views, if you give them enough room, they will actually hang themselves, or, confronted by strong opponents, will be exposed for what they are.
Well, at the moment, we're seeing the mass growth of fascist organisations across Europe, clearly debunked, but continuing to grow. I think it's naivety, actually, not to understand that if you put the right argument, that will stop people. Unfortunately, Marine, the facts are that since we've had a no-platform policy for fascists, the fascist organisations haven't been built. And actually, to be honest, the reason why the British National Party was defeated, there was a mass movement across the whole of this country that leafleted, demonstrated, had campaigns against him, and we convinced even people of his own supporters that he was a Nazi. And there's a difference between being a Nazi and being somebody who's objectionable, and that's what we convinced people of. I hate to say this, but no matter how powerful the arguments were put, it's ordinary people themselves that rejected the British National Party.
If you repress these views for long enough, do they not gain ground outside of the public sphere? And this repression leads to some sort of growth in the resentment that these ideas are also being repressed?
I'm talking about specifically Nazi ideas, right? The idea that you repress Nazi ideas and fascist ideas, and therefore if they're repressed, they grow, actually it's the opposite. The Nazis require respectability. They require universities to say you're the same as us, to treat them as equal. Once they have that oxygen and the respectability, they then use the oxygen to build bigger organisations. Now, we're not talking about people that are just nasty. To be honest, all of us are tough enough to deal with nasty people. I mean, that's life. But we're talking about people that specifically organise to destroy democracy.
And the lesson...
Yeah, well, yeah, 2 points. Yeah, some of us are tough, some of us are not. That's a big problem at universities now, isn't it? We're assuming a kind of meek and mild student who's unable to develop critical thinking and to use it. But also the point about going underground, which is a very important one, actually in a number of countries, police have noticed this. Again, if you look at France or Germany, where speech bans are much tighter, at this point, the neo-Nazi and the far right have become so sophisticated in communicating each other with each other and staying off the radar that the police are having more and more trouble tracking them. That actually helps them. It doesn't inhibit them. There was, a few years ago in Germany, a meeting of several thousand neo-Nazis, and the police could not find it. They didn't know about it because the neo-Nazis, because of these censorship laws, have become so good at surreptitious communication. So it is completely wrong to assume that cracking down means that they just go away. I think Peter rightly said that that's exactly what nourishes them. It makes them into free speech martyrs. I don't want these people to be martyrs. And again, the question once again arises, what about the left? What about what we saw in Hamburg with the entire German press saying this has also led to violence, this has also led to crime, indeed violence against minorities, curiously enough. Do we ban the Marxists?
Let's be clear. We have to be really clear about what we're trying to defend. We're trying to defend the right to go to campus, as what's happened in France, actually. It's uncomfortable to be a Muslim on campus.
Let me ask Peter about this. Yeah. Over the decades of campaigning, have you noticed a change in tolerance towards your advocacy, for example, perhaps because of demographics and other issues?
I think there is a section of the left that has become more censorious, that has sought to close down ideas and opinions that they don't agree with. And often I agree with their critique, but I don't agree that the most effective way to counter those ideas is by bans or no platforms. I mean, I think that freedom of speech is one of the most important and precious of all human rights. Some of the greatest ideas in history caused incredible offense in their time. Galileo Galilei, Charles Darwin, Karl Marx, Sigmund Freud. You know, if bans and censorship had been in place in their day, their ideas would have been suppressed, and that would have been a tragic loss to human civilization.
So for me,
it's really important that we have that freedom, but I do think there are three circumstances where free speech can be legitimately restricted. And those are if someone makes false, damaging allegations against another person, for example, to try and discredit them, accuses them of tax fraud or child sex abuse. That's an abuse, that's wrong.
So defamation.
Yeah. If someone is involved in harassment, threats, and menaces towards another person, or if they incite violence, those for me are the three red lines, because when you cross those three red lines, you're not actually facilitating open debate, you're closing it down because the people who are pilloried and victimized are afraid to speak out.
I'm sure you'd agree with those red lines,
but
you would presumably add others, for example, a matter of offense.
No, not necessarily. It's not necessarily about offense, because people are offended by many things in life. I could be offended by what someone's wearing, etc. It's not about offence. Some of those lines are really important. But what we have to realise is, I think for a lot of people, we're applying those lines to a lot more minority groups, groups that a lot of people just don't necessarily think about or understand, but actually those are our students on campus. And I think that's some of the issues. So when we talk about sometimes trans issues, etc., a lot of people are like, oh, well, I don't understand, they don't. But if you put the context in another different group, they would understand it a bit more, and I think that's part of the issue.
Within universities, you have hundreds of societies.
Of course,
so, for example, in the case of Maryam Namazi, the Iranian-born humanist, she is also a member of the Council of Ex-Muslims.
Yeah.
She went to the Goldsmiths University, and there she found opposition from the Islamic Society.
Yeah.
So when you have two different groups coming together like this, isn't it the right of someone like Maryam Namazi to talk freely and to be allowed to do so?
Well, it's also their right to protest her and to make it very clear and critique her, because actually we're saying that right there.
To protest her, but to actually enter the room and prevent her speaking, make it difficult for her to complete what she wants to say.
We just said here that people would face opposition. You just said people should be scrutinised, pressured, face opposition. I don't think there should be any violence, of course not, but they have every right to be on their campus, in their university, to oppose their view.
And to make it impossible for her to
talk. I don't think it was impossible. I hope it wasn't impossible, but I think it's really important to note that people should be able, I mean, impossible, maybe not, but being able to sort of have their viewpoint and for them to be equally protested. I've said to many student groups, this person speaking, you may not like them, stand outside and mobilise and have the biggest protest
that,
that you're more
of the Islamic Society there shouted out the key words, which were, you know, you're violating our safe space, discrimination, and they used that to try to shut it down.
Yeah.
It's just possible, isn't it, that the Islamic Society may have invited speakers who other groups will object to, and they will shout out the same key words to shut them down.
Yeah. And I think
aren't you really encouraging an environment where the person who is most quickly and easily offended gets to shut down the debate?
Not necessarily, because she still spoke. So they have every right to say that. And I think it's the power, sort of the systems in the union, etc., that have to facilitate those conversations. We have student groups on campus who don't like each other. They have different opinion views, but they still exist. And they still have it.
The biggest thing that exists on universities at the moment is Islamophobia. And it's come from the government, and there's prevent.
Huge.
So the idea that the people that have been most persecuted by racists at the moment are Muslims, and actually Muslims have been accused of being terrorists, Muslims have been accused of being, and people openly say this. In fact, people, Baroness Varsi said it's become the most respectable racism.
Yeah, it's easy.
People can be openly racist to Muslims compared to other groups and say things about them.
That's what hate speech laws are in place.
But actually they don't protect Muslim organisations.
Well, they protect hate speech against religion.
I think there's very limited protection for Muslim students on campus.
Let's bring in Eric Hines, who you have experience with campuses.
Challenge it, right? I mean, much of what you've been saying is about persuading people. How do people become persuaded when something is just shoved under the carpet? And also, I think I agree with a lot of what you're saying, but I think something that you're missing is that actually...
Have you signed up for the event?
Pardon?
Have you signed up for the event? You, as somebody who's a professor, if you hear a student change their dress or look different, aren't you under the new law supposed to report them?
No, I don't care.
I'm not saying those students are the most welcome in any of my classes. I'm just saying, but don't you acknowledge that there's a law now that says that they have to be watched in a different way? Mm-hmm. So I think we have to acknowledge this.
This is a very different issue from no platforming. With no platforming, we're talking about who can speak at a university and what they can say, right? Now, again, just getting back to your comments, I mean, I think you're giving a mild version of what we're really seeing on campuses, right? I mean, a classic example just a few months ago was Mark Regev. Now, you might think that he is a neo-Nazi, right? The former Israeli ambassador. Right? Now, the fact is that there was overwhelming pressure to disinvite him, or indeed to not let that go forward. Now, it might be that you disagreed with that, but many actually agreed with that. Mm-hmm. Much of not only the students, but even at the staff itself.
Let's just broaden this out for a moment.
Now, the fact is that I chaired that, and it ended up being one of the most challenging, one of the most openly confrontational, and therefore one of the most fruitful, important events that you could have. I wish that every controversial speaker could have that kind of event, far from being barred from campuses. Again, those are the people we have to be inviting, talking to, and students have to learn. Students are far too complacent.
Students think that
the fact is, what we find is that students are fine when they're talking with their pals. As soon as you bring in someone like David Irving, right, who starts with all sorts of
facts. Did you say David Irving?
Yes.
David Irving denies the Holocaust, doesn't he?
That's my point.
And he does it
persuasively because people have not learned how to argue with him. They don't have their facts. There are very few people.
I'm afraid to say that there are plenty of people that can argue why the Holocaust happened. There's Auschwitz if people are in trouble.
But the fact is, I have witnessed Holocaust deniers speak to people who were not very well informed, and the fact is, they were able to speak without being challenged.
I'd like to get a final thought from each of you. If we were to construct, for example, a golden rule, and I thought the golden rule had been spelled out by Voltaire, which was, I may not agree with what you're saying, but I defend to the death your right to say it, if indeed he did actually say it in those eloquent terms.
Yeah.
But if you were constructing a golden rule for free speech and universities and free speech more broadly, what would it be?
Yeah, learn how to argue with the people with whom you disagree. And keep practicing and practicing. The chances are, whoever you are, right up to the most senior professors, you're probably not as good at it as you think you are. It's a skill we have to hold
allow everyone to
throughout our whole lives if merits. We believe in democracy.
Nara, if I could just come to
I think one that's happening. We have debating unions. We have seminars. People are learning. I understand that there might be people, but I don't think that's any different from people from your generation to ours. I don't think because you had two or three more speakers on campus that somehow you're more articulate and able to converse arguments. But my takeaway is this: freedom of speech. Everyone has the right to speak, say whatever they want. They just don't have the right to say it wherever they want. I think that's a difference.
Wayman?
I defend the freedom of speech for everyone, but I draw the line of organising Nazis and racist. Voltaire said, I defend the right of you to speak, and he said that at his time, but to his death. Whose death are we talking about? The freedom of life comes above the freedom of speech, and that has to be protected.
Peter?
Well, I laid out the three red lines, and I think that, to be fair, the No Platform and Safe Space policy has been abused by some individual student unions, but not on the massive scale that's alleged. I think most student unions do strike the right balance, but there have been excessive cases, like the case of Imogen Wilson at Edinburgh University, where she raised her hand in objection to false allegations being made against her, and she was told that was a violation of the safe space policy.
I'm really sorry, but as someone who knows Imogen, actually, when she did that, she also said, I raised my hand, we had a discussion, members thing, and actually the policy worked because someone had an issue with what I had to say. I said, okay, I have a different opinion to you. They sorted out and the debate carried on.
No, thank you very much. Clearly, we have much more than the time allotted, but all of our panel, thank you very much for coming on Roundtable today. Well, some things are best perhaps left unsaid. But who should decide which voices are heard and which should be shut down? You've been watching Roundtable. I'm Matthew Moore. Thank you for watching.